Good morning. Good morning at the Jewish Museum Berlin on this Friday morning. Pretty early, actually. I'm happy we stick to the 15 minutes academic quarter. I'm standing here actually to give some practical information. That's sort of my role, this, I believe, in general in the museum. And practicalities in museums, in museum work, is of the utmost importance. There will be filming, so that is something that you need to know. We do have catering, but not for the for luncheon. But we have this wonderful brochure, and there's everything you need to know about all the foodie moments in the vicinity of the museum. So that's important as well. Okay. That was the practical information.
Well done.
My colleague, our colleague, Jasmin Schumann of our academy program should actually be standing here. But unfortunately, she has fallen ill. And as her mere substitute, I'm standing here now, so you're stuck with me. My name is Léontine Meijer-van Mensch, and I'm the program director of this museum. But it's an honor to be standing here and to be moderating the first session. And it was actually Jasmin Schumann and her team, thank you, who developed and planned this concept of this conference together with Professor Iman, Attia, from the Humboldt, from the Salomon University, and Professor Naika, Foroutan from the Humboldt University Berlin. And thank you for cooperating with us. Thank you so much. And why are cooperation so important for us, for me as a museum manager? I think it enriches us as institution, as museum professionals, and how we frame our worlds and our museum. And hopefully, it's also of benefit for our visitors. And this conference takes place within the framework of our academy programs. And the academy program widened the spectrum of the Jewish Museum Berlin's thematic focus when they were established 5 years ago. And with the realm of the academy, we want to be a platform for discussing questions posed by concepts like superdiversity, decolonizing, queering, inclusion, exclusion, representations, and participation in a pluralistic society. We, as a Jewish museum, and especially in Berlin, we think that it is vital and of utmost importance to explore the relationships between diverse minority groups and majority culture, and its representation, and promote exchange, network building, empowerment among minorities. So today, and also yesterday evening, it was about networking and also about solidarity. We would like to examine how marginalization, denigration, and experiences of exclusions affect Muslims or people who are perceived as such, and what strategies are developed to deal with this stigmatization, and what insights can be drawn from this experience. I'm looking forward to all the input, to all the discussions, and I know that I will learn a lot today. And once again, thank you for being with us here in the Jewish Museum Berlin. I give the floor to you.
Thank you very much, Léontine.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you so much for hosting our conference, our joint conference here in your house. As you might know, this day was meant to take place at the Humboldt University, but because of so many attraction and interest, we had to move and come back. And this was quite a management issue within 3 weeks, because we had planned with some 150 people, and then we had 500 registrations. And so we had to move back. And thank you again for making everything possible.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you. Okay. You already mentioned that the starting of the conference has taken place yesterday, and we were talking a lot about strategic alliances, about what you mentioned, positions of minorities in super diverse societies. And as one of the directors of the Berlin Institute for Integration and Migration Research at Humboldt University, I also would like to warmly welcome to our international conference that is titled Living with Islamophobia. Please allow me some brief thoughts on our conference theme before we introduce you to our distinguished guests who have come from all over the world and who will be introduced to you throughout the panels by their panel chairs. The topic of Islamophobia intersects with many different areas of social sciences, such as migration and integration research, racism studies, minority studies, cultural studies, and many more. In that regard, we are proud to have achieved such an interdisciplinary mix of research perspectives today that all discuss the phenomenon of Islamophobia from the perspectives of those affected by it, while exploring their ways of dealing with anti-Muslim racism. It is almost common knowledge what discrimination, difficulties, and obstacles marginalized groups and certain minorities face in regard to social mobility in Western Europe and in the United States. In Germany, we have evidence that individuals with foreign names have harder times scoring jobs, attaining middle or upper tier positions, or even finding accommodation. Discrimination follows these individuals on a long-term basis and can reduce their overall chances in education, labor market integration, professional success, as well as their social and cultural integration. At our institute at Humboldt University, my colleagues have published a study on the impact of attitudes and expectations of teachers on students with a Turkish background. The findings are striking and important to talk about. They reveal a systematic disadvantage of Turkish background students on a primary school level that affects their performance due to prejudiced views of their teachers towards them. At the same time, a similar study conducted by my colleagues Erin Salikut look at our institute shows that education aspiration among Turkish background students in Germany, in German schools, are higher than those of their German peers with no migration background, due to immigrant optimism. So we see high education aspirations among Turkish students, which contrast assumptions of teachers that these children are seemingly not interested in education because they are Turkish. And this is due to the prejudice that Muslim parents are apparently not very interested in educational matters. I'm going to come back to that with another empirical study to prove this prejudice. So the fact that these children are negated their chances in accomplishment due to biased behavior towards them from early age on has concrete and severe consequences for their development and belonging in society. The question of belonging is a topic we have also explored in our empirical studies, where we were able to exemplify the outgrouping of Muslims in various items. Our study, Deutschland Postmigrantisch, or Post-Migrant Germany, surveyed the German population on questions of national identity. In one particular item, that was a survey experiment, respondents were presented with a variety of statements in which Muslims were compared with a collective we, which after that, we were able to define this collective we with some follow-up questions. Two of these statements contain two stereotypes, such as Muslims are more aggressive than we are, or Muslim parents are as interested in education as we are. As mentioned before, despite the prejudice that Muslim parents apparently don't raise their children to having high education aspirations, we have found in many studies that Turkish children and other studies for Muslim children in special, that they have higher education aspirations than their peer due to this fact of immigrant optimism. Regardless, only every second person answered that they would think Muslim parents to be as interested in education as we are. And you know, this every second person, as I showed you before, has an effect on the further career of these children. The follow-up question in this survey experiment was, who did you actually have in mind when hearing the word we? Interestingly, we found that the we group was mainly consistent of describing us, the we, as Germans, German population, or simply Germany. So people could have answered in a different way. They could have said, like, well, we the Christians, or we the non-Muslims. But apparently being Muslim and being German seems to contrast each other to that part that it seems to have built opposite sides to each other. And that despite the fact that nearly half of the 6 million Muslims living in this country are German nationals. Such answers describe a narrative exclusion. Muslims in Germany are not considered part of the collective we and are not seen as members of the national identity here, even though this country describes itself as a country of immigration since 2001. So over the last years, there has been a dramatic increase in Islamophobic positions in this country. Since 2009, the share of people holding Islamophobic views has nearly doubled. 60% of the German population would describe Islam as threatening and not fitting into the Western world. Nearly every third person would describe Islam as something that scares them personally. Half of the German population feels like a stranger in their own country due to the number of Muslims living here. And please have in mind that only 6% of the German population is of Muslim faith. However, every second person fears that this minority is too influential. More interesting than that, however, is a normative paradox that we found in regards to Muslims. While most Germans accept democratic values of equality and approve of giving rights to minorities, they would like to revoke it when it comes to Muslims. The same study I mentioned above revealed that German society is willing to accept participatory rights of Muslims on an abstract level. On a concrete level, they would like to reject these rights so far. While a majority of the population, nearly 70%, cognitively accepts Muslim rights, 60% of the population would, however, like to forbid religious circumcision of boys, 50% would forbid the wearing of headscarves for school teachers, and 40% would forbid the constructions of mosques in this country. So what can we learn from that? Among others, that religion appears to be an important marker that affects the othering, outgrouping, and disintegration of those labeled with that marker. And that outgrouping and discrimination is happening while Germany understands itself as a country of immigration that is proud of its plural democracy. So this mismatch is something that we are all dealing with at the moment. Germany, Great Britain, France, and the United States, where many of today's speakers are coming from, are societies that in theory are based on their constitutions and therefore accept and respect the norms of equality, plurality, and democracy. And while we have parts of society that have internalized these values, we still have large parts in society that fight minority rights and equality, especially when it comes to visible minorities, such as black people, Muslims, or people with a faith that is non-Christian, like Jewish or other faiths. So in Germany, we do not speak about race so much, but mainly about nationality. The term race is negatively stigmatized in the German context, mainly due to the Holocaust past. Hence, we have not had the same discussion on race and racism in Germany like my colleague Iman, who is one of the rare persons working on this in Germany, explicitly mentioned yesterday. The question of race is used or can be used to address racism, social injustice, and discrimination against minorities. That's why it is so important to have these studies more placed here in our country. The UK, for example, is currently addressing the issue of a race pay gap and is thinking about implementing a law to ask firms to reveal figures of their race pay gap to tackle ethnic inequality in the UK. My colleague Nancy Foner in the US raises the question in her research whether Islam in Europe functions like race in the United States. And by doing so, she is bringing in a new research perspective that helps to establish tools against Islamophobia while at the same time advancing social science research on Islamophobia. So this is why we want to dedicate our conference today to the question of living with Islamophobia, or as we discussed yesterday, maybe we rather shall say anti-Muslim racism. What we want to do today is we want to dig deeper into processes of racialization. We want to explore securitization discourses and sexualization processes in regards to Muslims. And we want to talk about strategies of empowerment in times of rising insecurities. This is what our three panels will be addressing throughout the conference today. In the evening session, we will recap research perspectives dedicated to the question of living with Islamophobia. Our three panels this morning will be in English. Our last panel, which will be mainly a discussion about the conference and about this issue in Germany, will be in German, and we will translate it into English. And now, with further ado, I ask my dear colleague to open up the first panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this first framing. Talking about relevancy and why this conference should take place here, I think it's already clear, right? I would like to ask the well-esteemed panelists to come up to the floor, as my wonderful colleague Hafsa as well. Please join me. Test. It works. Great. After the start yesterday with an outstanding keynote and wonderful panelists where international perspectives on Islamophobia and different forms of counter strategies were being addressed, we want to continue the discussion by shifting to a topic that we think is necessary to understand the phenomenon Islamophobia. I already introduced myself, and therefore I would like to give my colleague Hafsa the chance to do the same. My dear.
Thank you. My name is Hafsa Al-Muhamushi, and I'm a research associate at the Academy at the Jewish Museum. And I'm really delighted about the great interest in the conference. I'm looking forward to our panel on processes of racialization, together with our program director, Léontine, Meijer-van, Mensch. And at this point, I would also like to warmly welcome all of you today. And we will afterwards represent you in the following. Thank you.
Great. Now you understand why I'm so proud to work with such wonderful colleagues. We dedicate this morning to processes of racialization and asking the question of which concept of race is the underlying notion of Islamophobia. Above all, I think the purpose of the Living with Islamophobia conference is to unfold and unpack the questions that ponder on everyday Muslim life. When are Muslims generally affected by racialization, and how can we explain the entanglement of culture, religion, and race? And the panel joins the current, I hope, I'm looking forward, that it joins the current state of research. And with our speakers, we have, I know, excellent experts, and you have been dealing with the effects of this racialization already for quite some time. On our first panel, we have Professor Janan Ghazal-Reed from the Duke University, Professor Nazar Mir from University of Edinburgh, and Professor Unite Rana from the University of Illinois. And I hope you're coping with your jet lags. Please note, that's for all you guys, that we first have the speakers present their lectures as an input and listen to all the presentations before we are opening up the panel. And after the lectures, we have enough time to collect questions and discuss them together. Otherwise, the time runs short, and that would be a pity. Professor Unite Rana will open up this panel. He's an associate professor of Asian American Studies at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He's the author of Terrifying Muslims, Race and Labor in the South Asian Diaspora, that was published 2011. He was the winner of the 2013 Association of Asian American Studies Book Award in the Social Science. Good for you. And he's the co-editor of White Stones in Our Hands, Writing on Racism, Muslims, and Empire, which was published this year in 2018. His recent essays have appeared in American Quarterly Journal of Asian American Studies, Social Text, and South Atlantic Quarterly. And in his talk, he will discuss questions of how processes of racialization actually function. He states that they are embedded in historical contexts, while the effects are continuing till today and shape our thinking in terms of categories of race and culture. Professor Rana, the floor is all yours.
Thank you. I think I'm going to go to the sun's right in my face. Thank you. Yeah, the sun was in my face over there. The sun's in my face over here, too. Oh, yeah, I'm sure it wasn't planned. first off, I'd like to thank the organizers of the conference. This is a really great honor to be here, Hafsa, Yulia, Iman, so many of you who put the work to make this happen in the context of a place like Germany, in a time now where political conversation seems to be narrowing in a particular way. So in my talk today, I'd like to share with you a couple of things. The title of my talk is, What is Anti-Muslim Racism? That's a very broad question, and that's only the beginning of sort of three points that I'd like to address. So what I'll start with is, one, this conceptual question, what exactly is anti-Muslim racism? What are we talking about? What are the theoretical stakes, if you will? Two, and this gets into some of my ethnographic work that I'll be sharing with you. How can we think about our methods in dealing with this conceptual question? In terms of thinking about anti-Muslim racism, I, along with a number of anthropologists, have been thinking through what we are calling the anthropology of white supremacy, right? So in thinking about racism in relationship to white supremacy, what are the kinds of things that we can study? How do we study these things, right? How do we study racism in relationship to white supremacy? What does that look like? Again, what are the theoretical stakes? And then finally, the third point that I'll address, hopefully I can do this all in 20 minutes, what is anti-racist solidarity? So in a way, I want to have a response to these initial conceptual and methodological questions in terms of thinking about a range of not only a political action in response to racism, but what exactly it looks like. How do we know that what we're looking at is in fact a form of anti-racism, forms of solidarity, forms of political action? So let me begin with this first question. And thanks to the speakers yesterday, Maida and Iman introduced this question of a range of responses to think about anti-Muslim racism. So really quickly, because I know we're short on time, and I'm sure many of the speakers today, throughout the day, will be addressing this. One of the things that I'm proposing and thinking about this question is, on the one hand, the very basic question, what is racism? But when we add sort of the notion of anti-Muslim racism, what are the particularities that we think of that makes racism itself anti-Muslim? Now, often when I give papers or I talk about this topic, people will easily agree to the fact that, yes, Muslims face racism. But what makes it specific to Muslims, right? What are the particularities? How might we talk about specificities? So from my perspective, and I've been working on this for some years now, and in my book that was mentioned in the introduction, one of the things that I theorize in that book, and I've been thinking about ever since then, and writing in the new work that I'm doing, is to think about how racism is itself, on the one hand, flexible, right? It adapts, it's historical, it shifts, but then simultaneously, it's not just, it certainly is also a practice, and it is something that is active, right? Often we think about racism as something that somebody does to another person, right? And that there's something collective associated with it. But I would push that even further to ask the question of what makes racism systemic itself? How is it imbricated? How does it become part of social systems in a broader formation? And just jumping ahead, one might ask that same question of white supremacy, right? Often when we think about white supremacy, we think of it as something that individual actors are doing, that individual actors in a political sort of realm are acting as white supremacists. But then how might we even think of white supremacy as itself a system, right? So in thinking about this, and one of the ways that I'd like to contribute at least to our conversation is to draw on the work of Stephen Shehi, who recently published an essay in that book that I also worked on, with stones in our hands. I know this isn't an ad for me, but it's just, you know, something there. It's Stephen Shehi's work. But he gives us this provocation, which I think is a very useful one to think about, which is that Islamophobia is itself a racial formation. Let me repeat that. Islamophobia is itself a racial formation. And here he's drawing on the work of US sociologists Michael Omi and Howard Wannant, who argue that racial formation in the United States and increasingly in the world, they talk about a global racial formation, that racial formation is a way to think about how social structures use race and racism in sort of not only everyday life, but how we think about society, politics, economics, etc. Now, in saying that Islamophobia is racial formation, I think this gets at what many of us who argue about the utility of whether we should be talking about Islamophobia or anti-Muslim racism, really gets at sort of the heart of the issue. Now, on the one hand, for me, Islamophobia, while it is a clear activist discourse, it is something that is very palpable. We understand it in a particular way. There is a kind of politics to using the framing of Islamophobia. For me, Islamophobia is there. It has a problematic in that it psychologizes a problem, right? I mean, it's in the word itself. It's a phobia. The psychologization also makes it into an individual act as opposed to a collective act, right? Some of the comments that were addressed yesterday. Now, I have a lot more to say that, but I want to narrow the conversation a little bit and sort of shorten the comments. For me, what the turn to anti-Muslim racism reveals is, again, the way that we might think about collective action or systemic action, right? How those sorts of things, in the case of figuring something like what the Muslim is, the figure of the Muslim, as it's been called, what that might, that racial figure, how that racial figure is itself imagined as an object. Now, in addressing this conceptual question, right, and part of the challenge that we have at hand is to demonstrate, one, how do we study this? Two, where do we find evidence for it, right? So as an ethnographer, these are some of the questions that are part of, again, as I've been talking about, one, the anthropology of white supremacy, but also within the discipline of anthropology, the, you know, several decades work from feminist anthropologists, from anthropologists of color, who've been studying the framework of how to think about racism. So even in studying racism and something like white supremacy, right, the thinking about this, right, theorizing on the one hand this conceptual question draws us to imagine a lot of the ways that these things can emerge, right? So from very practical formations that we think about in terms of how there are forms of discrimination, forms of boundary making, forms of what some will call premature death, the kind of range of activities that lead to this kind of systemic activity, right? So in sharing these questions around what a method of the anthropology of white supremacy might look like, one of the starting points here is to say that white supremacy is not just an individual act, but much like racism, it is the ideological and underpinning of racism itself. That white supremacy is linked formally in a way that we can think about systems of social structure that are shaping how society is operating in particular ways. So the challenge here, right? And so let me slow down in terms of what I'm talking about, because the stakes are, the theoretical stakes of this kind of a claim would have us think that on the one hand, where we imagine anti-racist activity is about getting people to change their minds, right? So that if one is going to act against racism, it's to be aware that racism is out there, but also to say that I'm not a racist, right? But what I'm proposing here is that we're in much more troubling space, that in fact, when we think about systemic forms, this requires us to undo massive ways that we already think, that we already act in society, right? So how might we do that? So in my example that I'd like to provide, because I've already spoke for like almost 15 minutes, I didn't realize that was gonna happen so quickly. So the example that I'd like to provide is to think about racism and white supremacy through anti-racism itself, right? So what does it look like, right? How might we see politics not only as contained identities where we say that there are those who act as conservative or those who act as liberals or radicals, but that politics itself is fluid, right? That there's no given in how we might ascribe a particular politics to a particular actor, right? But that in also thinking about, and partly where I enter into this ethnographic story, is to think about protest itself, right? What does protest actually provide us? Is it always necessarily radical? What does protest as dissent allow us to think about? So for the last 10 years since I finished the last book, I've been doing an ethnography in a Pakistani neighborhood in Brooklyn. And in this neighborhood, I've come across a number of individuals who've reported to me participating not only in the neighborhood politics, because it's a Pakistani neighborhood with many mosques, it's what sociologists would call an ethnic enclave, if you will, but have also reported to me some of sort of the early 80s and 90s experiences of participating in protest politics in another neighborhood, right? Another neighborhood which is predominantly black, which is predominantly a very different kind of ethnic neighborhood in Bedford-Stuyvesant. So rather than going through the geography of Brooklyn, just believe me, they're not really close to each other. The neighborhood I'm talking about is Midwood, and the other neighborhood is Bedford-Stuyvesant. So the mosques they're talking about, that they were participating in these protests, was Masjid al-Taqwa, which is a predominantly African-American mosque that in the early 80s started as a response of a number of people who were formerly part of the Nation of Islam, but had then changed over to Sunni Islam. Some of them followed the practices of Wardeen Muhammad and his community in shifting away from the Nation of Islam. But in creating this new mosque in the Bedford-Stuyvesant area, what was interesting was that what these protests were about were that they were anti-liquor and anti-drug protests, right? So here you had a call from an imam who was an African American who was basically saying that what needs to happen in this neighborhood is that we need to rid it of or clean it of drugs, the drug economy, and the ills that are brought by liquor stores, right? Liquor as a kind of a problem that leads to conditions of poverty and impoverishment, which in many sort of theological arguments, right? Many Friday prayers, Friday sermons, Friday khutbas, right? The discourse around thinking about drugs and thinking about liquor was argued as part of white supremacy. So let's pause on this. What does that actually mean? How might we actually imagine the conditions that in a neighborhood where all the indicators point to conditions of poverty, conditions of a particular kind of drug economy that has created this range of issues in that neighborhood itself? The way the imam would talk about it was to say that what white supremacy in relationship to what we could also call capitalism, right? The capitalist sort of economy of drugs, of alcohol, was part of the poison that was infesting the neighborhood, right? It was leading to all sorts of relationships to the prison industrial complex. It was leading to all kinds of relationships to other ways of thinking about how the neighborhood itself was imagined as a site in which nothing really changed in relationship to poverty. But part of the agenda of the mosque and part of the reason why it even started in that neighborhood was to make an argument to say that, and this draws on the politics of the Nation of Islam, that there was an idea of self-determination, right? Now, in many ways, the Nation of Islam ideas of self-determination are very conservative in a way, right? There's clear gender roles, there's ideas of comportment, ideas of revitalization in terms of existing within a liberal society. but yet there's something about, again, going back to these protests that brought Muslims from South Asian neighborhoods, from Arab neighborhoods, from other neighborhoods into this center to basically say that, again, they were protesting in public spaces against drug dealers, right? Against the police, against liquor store owners, right? A range of actors which we could put on all sorts of places of the spectrum of what their contribution would be to what we could imagine as the spaces in which capitalism and white supremacy, or even what some scholars are drawing on to combine those ideas to call racial capitalism. Now, what this lesson sort of provides is a way to think about the politics of anti-racist solidarity that is not only fluid in the sense of there are ways, there are these moments of radicalism that could, that lead to the emergence of a different set of possibilities, right? So fast forward to the present moment, after 30, 40 years of this activism in the neighborhood, the neighborhood has dramatically changed. Now, and what's clear about that change is that on the one hand, what sociologists would call gentrification, because gentrification is clearly happening in this neighborhood, that this mosque also contributed to the gentrification process itself. Now, gentrification, when it's often talked about, has this kind of negative valence. But how might we think about this in a more complex way? Right? What did it mean for this group of Muslims who decided to make roots in this neighborhood and then change the political dynamics of the neighborhood itself so that they themselves imagine themselves as living in this neighborhood, right? And part of these narratives, part of the emergence was a critique of not only white supremacy, it was a critique of capitalism, it was a critique of racism. But yet, in some ways, right, part of what they ended up doing was precisely in the capitalist economy, right? Raising the market value of housing, raising, shifting the sort of commercial interests in that neighborhood, but again, within that system. So what I'd like to leave us with is this sort of thinking around on this final question of what is anti-racist solidarity and what does it necessarily get us, right? On the one hand, part of the critique of racism is to say that we have to understand how racism is operating intersectionally with other systems, right? Of other systems of oppression, homophobia, sexism, religious discrimination, et cetera. But also to think about where that ends up in terms of that critique. The critique of those forms of oppression also ask us to think about the society that comes after. So I'll end there and pass it on. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I was wondering about this part of Kreuzberg in your talk and what we as a museum can also contribute to this neighborhood in a positive way. Thank you for this fundamental insights in racial logics and the entanglement of it all. Food for thought. Our next speaker is Professor Nazar Mir. You are Professor of Race, identity and citizenship in the School of Social and Political Science at the University of Edinburgh. His publications include Islam and Modernity, Interculturalism and Multiculturalism, Debating the Dividing Lines, 2016, Citizenship, Identity and the Politics of Multiculturalism, The Rise of Muslim Consciousness, 2015, that was published, and the topic of today, this morning, Racialization and Religion, 2014, and a book on race and ethnicity, 2014. Wow, you publish all so much. How do you do? I'm a bit jealous, I must say. You will talk about racialization relations, a beautiful alliteration, I think. I'm looking forward so much to your input. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that very... Does that mean I should finish? Thank you very much for that generous introduction and the welcome more broadly. It's an honor to be here. I first came to this museum when I was a teenager, and I've been back many times since, and it's a real privilege to be standing here speaking. So why have I called my talk Racialization Relations? Well, I guess I'm partly taking up the cue or the challenge set to us by the American writer David Theo Goldberg in his book Racist Culture, in which he says, the challenge is to trace what he called are the intercoursing connectivities of the racial, and which in simple terms I've always understood him to mean that instead of just comparing and contrasting racial experiences, perhaps the challenge is to try to connect more between one and another so that we get beyond a series of what may otherwise be internal debates. Now, I've been struck by that very simple observation because if you take it seriously enough, it forces you to challenge some otherwise quite pioneering and profound scholarship. Take, for example, in his poignant Remnants of Auschwitz, Giorgio Agamben, the Italian philosopher, makes a provocative observation, one that he partly gets from the anthropologist Primo Levi, who was a survivor of the camp. In reminding readers of the wider use term Musulmana to describe the most wretched of those incarcerated in that camp, often bent double in a prostrate position as if in prayer, the Musulmana, I quote, became the name for those Jews in the concentration camps who had left life but not yet given into death. Now, these semantic connections are not really pursued in Giorgio Agamben's own work because he recoils, I think, from relating the ways in which the condition of the Musulmana may signal or point to a kind of a racial history of the Jew and the Muslim. Now, it's a relational problematic that I think has only relatively recently been charted in the works of people like Junaid Rana, Mustafa Bayami, Eric Love, a number of other people who are both here and not with us today. And it's also, I think, present in some work that my colleagues and I did a few years ago in the collection which was trailed on racialization and religion, in which we tried to locate the contemporary study of antisemitism and Islamophobia squarely within the fields of race and racism. There were female contributors to this book, they just had better things to do when it came to taking a picture. Now, in this talk, I'd kind of like to carry on that activity and try to explore how racialization relations can help us to understand how Muslims are racialized and how the signs of religious difference are constituted as racial sites. Now, that's not an easy task. I think on the one hand, you know, we're faced with a historical narrative about the emergence of race as a profoundly secular and modern phenomenon, one that has its genesis perhaps in Atlantic slavery, and something that's, I think, become entrenched as the prevailing view. On the other hand, you know, we're cautioned by people like David Theo Goldberg himself that, you know, racialization in the literature is such a broad concept that at the very least, it can be ambiguous and it can also be vacuous. So there's kind of an analytical challenge as well as a historical challenge. But in addition to this, there's also, I think, a political challenge. And that has to do with the discursive opposition of placing Islamophobia and antisemitism in the same tier as each other and in the same register as race. So in attempting to bring ideas of racialization to the study of these matters, I think we're firstly engaging in a degree of historical revision. Secondly, we're seeking a kind of analytical precision. Thirdly, we're being politically aware. Okay, well, beginning with this issue of provenance, you know, there's a long-standing, I think, methodological and probably philosophical question as to whether the possession of a concept can predate the possession of a corresponding word. In other words, you know, did race exist before we called it race? Now, without seeking to resolve that this morning, you know, if you're persuaded that language is both constituted, if it kind of makes us, as well as reflective, we kind of say something about the world out there, then I think you can start to take issue with one of the central features of what's known as a modernist thesis, and that race making is something which emerges as an outcome of a particular story of Atlantic slavery and so on. This is true of a number of colleagues I would point to, people who characterize themselves as decolonial scholars, people who characterize themselves as race scholars, and who would say that, well, race in a meaningful sense only really emerges from the 16th, 17th century onwards, and has to do ultimately with the story of European colonization, especially of North America, and then what we call now the Global South. Now, one of the things I think this attempt to understand race overlooks is the ways in which there's ample evidence that religious culture and biology are deemed to be constitutive of a racial category long before Atlantic slavery and long before colonial encounters, even prior to the Reconquista in 1492. You know, when Muhammad is first encountered in Europe, the Prophet Muhammad, with his alleged Jewish parents, is embodied as a dark-skinned satanic menace. Note Pope Urban II's extortion at Clermont in 1095 to take up the cross in the First Crusade, which included his description of how the Holy Land and much of Byzantium had been taken by the Turks, an accursed race, a slave of demons, and urged his co-religionists to exterminate that vile race from the lands of their brethren. So what's being argued, I suppose, in my work and in the book that has been trailed, is that the modernist thesis probably accurately captured many of the mechanics of race making, racialization, racial formation, but the account needs to begin much sooner to recognize how racialized categories have saturated cultural portrayals of Muslims and Jews, endowing each, I think, with characteristics that offer reassurance that their difference could easily be identified as non-Christian. So the point is about antecedents, where these things come from, rather than a perfect fit or about symmetry. And I think in different ways, people like Nabil Mata and James Shapiro have provided a very rich discussion of how ideas of the Moor and ideas of the Jew featured in Elizabethan England. And in the period's most celebrated author, you know, namely Shakespeare's characterization of the tragically violent Othello and the shrewd and sinister Shylock, you know, while each are replete with redeeming characters and even by today's standards, you know, they are nonetheless kind of make sense as racial affectations of their time. And the important thing is that for Shakespeare, no less than his audiences, these ideas of the Moor and the Jew, you know, were shorthand for non-Christian racial difference. So in this respect, it's Christianity which provided the vocabulary for difference in the Western world. Now, that point starts to lead to the next one about precision, so what we're using the term racialization to mean. Now, I've always found a kind of a helpful means of trying to address Theo Goldberg's challenge at the outset is to turn to people like Stephen Small's distinction between the racialization problematic, you know, the big theoretical framework of analysis, and the process of racialization, that is, the process of attribution to minorities who become the sites of these racial inscriptions, which unfolds historically and continues to change and adapt. I think the latter allows us to move away from thinking about racism as a form of biological determinism, about phenotype, body form, hair texture, which might leave little ways to think about how racialization draws on other characteristics in addition to physical appearance, including religion and culture and so forth. Yeah, and I take my cue from Bob Biles' conception of racialization, you know, as a means of understanding the ways in which racial processes can attribute in his terms, meaning to a thematic, to thematic characteristics in a way that presumes a social psychological theory which explains the nature and dynamics of that process. Quite wordy, but I think what's important about that way of thinking about racialization is that it speaks to both kind of cognitive, attitudinal, and structural tendencies and the ways in which they interact. So it helps us to understand things like institutional racism. And it facilitates a focus not on religious bigotry or on prejudice, but on people, on groups, on minorities who are the sites of racial inscriptions. A good European-wide example was found in the summary report on Islamophobia published by the now Fundamental Rights Agency. And what's particularly interesting in that set of surveys is that despite the variations in the number of experiences of Muslims across the European Union was that the overarching feature that emerged was for Muslim women to be attacked because of how the hijab signified an Islamic identity. Now, that's precisely what people like Bob Myers are trying to get to, the ways in which racism gets mixed up with other kinds of isms. And it's a finding, I think, that's very problematic for people who want to distinguish antipathy towards Islam and antipathy towards Muslims. What's common in these kinds of findings is that actually they interact. Because of what is the indication of following Islam? Okay, well, it's a physical manifestation of a religious observance, the headscarf. Now, in the contemporary period, we find some of the challenges to this characterized in this kind of framing of the good Muslim, bad Muslim dichotomy, where it's often said that, well, actually, our complaint isn't about Muslims, it's about the wrong kinds of Muslims. I think this book is a nice illustration of the kinds of arguments that's true here, and especially the ways in which kind of boundaries of legitimate and illegitimate political dissent are frequently drawn. You know, can a Muslim speak up about international relations, about foreign policy, about security policy at home, and not be racialized? You know, can they be moderate Muslims? Can they be progressive Muslims? Can they be liberal Muslims if they disagree with national level policy? You know, and what do those things even mean in the context where racialization pervades the political discourse? So when we're thinking about how we can try to grasp cross-national experiences of Islamophobia, you know, we inevitably turn to data, and there's different kinds of data. There's qualitative data, there's national-level data, there's cross-national data. And one of those cross-national pieces of data that I've been using for a few years now comes from Pew, and it's the Global Attitude Survey, which is a survey of almost 25,000 people in 24 countries. And the reason I always point to it is that one of its key findings when it asks this question, you know, can you self-identify in terms of how you'd respond to these minorities, is this correlation, this strong relationship between anti-Jewish and anti-Muslim sentiment in the West. And indeed, what they find in this survey and what we found in the latter survey that some of us have been part of is that actually negative attitudes towards Muslims is a predictor of negative attitudes towards Jews. Who'd have thought it? And vice versa, negative attitudes towards Jews is a predictor of negative attitudes towards Muslims. So in the US and the six European countries included in the survey, you know, the correlation of unfavorable opinions of Jews and Muslims is remarkably quite high. And I suppose the point that I illustrate with this figure is that this is an overlapping articulation of both, rather than it being something which happens in a tiered hierarchy. You know, it's not the case that we like this group, but we don't like that group. There's a profound relationship between the two. Which is, I suppose, something of a challenge to some of the theoretical work that was happening at a point of more optimism before the European crisis some years ago. I think of the work of people like Matti Bunzel, who is the anthropologist in the US, who took the view that where we are at the present is that the nature of anti-Semitism had changed. You know, it's not necessarily the old complaint about meddling with ethnic purity. Actually, from the perspective of elites within most nation states, you know, anti-Semitism isn't a part of the political option for them in terms of their politics. There's something else going on. There's kind of a supranational thing going on where Islam is increasingly seen as a prevailing challenge to the very idea of Europe itself. Now, Matti was writing, you know, some years ago, and whether or not I think, you know, he's too optimistic, I think the problematic he identifies is quite pressing. One thinks of the ways in which Valéry Giscard d'Estaing, you know, the former president of France, the convener of the Lisbon Treaty, argued that the status of Muslims in Europe is much more precarious because they have a different culture, a different approach, a different way of life. You know, pertinent here too is the late Pim Fortuyn's insistence on the need to defend a Judeo-Christian humanistic culture, and the ways in which he characterized Judaism as a creative and constructive element in society in contrast to Islam. Or as his most natural heir, Geert Wilders, puts it, as long as Europe is unwilling to defend the ideas of Rome, of Athens, of Jerusalem, it will lose everything. You know, our identity, our culture, our democracy, our rule of law, our liberties, our freedom. Hence, Marine Le Pen, in the French presidential election, characterized herself as a defender of European Jewry and argued, I quote, "The Jews understand who is truly responsible for antisemitism in Europe." But this isn't the preserve of the far right. This stuff gets picked up in places like Mark Stein's book, who wrote this best-selling account, America Alone, which made the confident prediction that much of the Western world will not survive this century, and what we loosely call the West will effectively disappear in our lifetimes. I suppose, in a nutshell, I suppose, he put it where he said, Europe has age and welfare. Put differently, pre-modern Islam beats postmodern Christianity. You know, this kind of Eurabia panic, that the very presence of Islam and Muslims in Europe is a signal of our demise, of our decline. And he has some pretty blood-curdling prescriptions for it. How do you resolve this? You know, he talks about the ways in which the Serbs figured it out as the rest of the continentals will. You know, if you can't outbreed them, cull them. New York Times bestseller. You know, so this argument about kind of Eurabia, you know, has been argued by people like Matt Carr to have many of the kind of essential features of things like the protocols, you know, in terms of presenting European Muslims as agents in a conspiratorial agenda of world domination. So you might think that this would be a really fertile ground for Muslim and Jewish collaboration to tackle antisemitism. Alas, some of the rationales and spaces for that solidarity face the kinds of hierarchies that I was talking about at the beginning. Rensman and Shepse's book, for example, talks about these two categories being incommensurable. They say, look, antisemitism has motivated, you know, these mass movements, declared Jews enemies of mankind and so on, none of which we find in even the most radical forms of public anti-Muslim resentment. Now, I'm the first to say that a cursory, let alone detailed reading of history is full of the evidence of the ways in which the Jewish experience has given rise to new vocabularies of persecution. My point simply is to say that I don't think the racial logic respects the kind of boundaries that people like Rensman and Sheps want to put around it. And I hope I've tried to illustrate that to you. But perhaps in addition to the kind of analytical challenge of thinking about these two together through an idea of race, you know, it's a political one I trailed at the beginning. And the ways in which, you know, globally transmitted violent encounters, you know, transform imaginaries about Muslim and Jewish relations. And one concerns, of course, a salient debate in my country, which is still very live. And it's about the analytical utility of designating hostility to Zionism as a new form of antisemitism. And my position is, yes, it can take that form. But in the literature that detects the new antisemitism, something much greater is being proposed. People like Brian Klug set it out as this. They say, at its strongest, there's a qualitative claim that anti-Zionism and hostility to Israel are anti-Semitic. At other times, the claim is quantitative. It amounts to saying that predominantly, and for the most part, those attitudes are anti-Semitic. And there is therefore, in any given case, the burden of proof is on those who deny the allegation. Now, I think about the ways in which criteria don't settle an argument, you know, and so I'm just kind of going to leave this hanging in the air, except to say that scholarship on antisemitism has mixed views on this. And I think about people like Weber, who kind of set it out, I think, best when he said that, you know, European Jews live with this awareness that many Israelis see them as part of a people inhabiting an incurably antisemitic environment. And some of the some may well accept this to be true, and it's quite a different picture from the one promoted by, you know, the European Union. But what indeed is most typical as a model for contemporary Europe? And so, in practice, you know, there's kind of views from the inside, there's views from the outside, and one of the challenges that people like me working on anti-Semitism and Islamophobia tries to encourage is a kind of an analytical path through that politics, which can be quite hazardous. So where does this leave us in thinking about racialization relations? Well, you know, although they're not kind of passive objects of racism, you know, Jewish and Muslim minorities in contemporary Europe are obviously not free of these external pressures and objectification that is borne by racialized tendencies. What I think is required are conceptions of anti-Semitism and Islamophobia that are able to explain how prejudice and discrimination simultaneously draws upon signs of race, on culture, and belonging in a way in which is by no means reducible to hostility to religion alone. You know, we need to think about the ways in which religious social identities, you know, have a political relevance because of the ways in which they're tied up with community identity, with stereotyping, with socioeconomic location, with political conflict, and so forth. Now, some of this is, I think, you know, a theoretical activity. It's trying to scope out the terrain, but a lot of it is also an empirical activity, generating the research and talking to people. And so I'm going to hand over to colleagues who are going to do a little bit more of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Again, a very inspiring talk and a lot of food for thought. Just one footnote is I was always already skeptical towards the bestseller, but now I'm even more skeptical. You want to take over? Great.
Our next speaker is Professor Janan Ghazal-Reed, and she's a professor of sociology and global health at Duke University and a Carnegie Scholar. Dr. Reed's research focuses on the assimilation of Arabs and Muslims in the US and Western Europe, specifically on issues of political integration, gender relations, and health. She has published widely on these topics, including a book and numerous articles. And she has also appeared as an expert on numerous national and international shows, such as the Charlie Rose Show, National Public Radio, and Al Jazeera English. Professor Reed has received several prestigious awards and grants, including ones from the Carnegie Corporation of New York, Russell Sage Foundation, and the U.S. Census Bureau. In her talk today, she discusses the realities of American Muslims and their experiences on living with Islamophobia. She do not only traces the contingency of developments after 9/11, but she also examines how Donald Trump's current foreign and immigration policies help to stylize American Muslims as a threat. Professor Ghazal-Reed, welcome.
Thank you, thank you. Good morning, everyone. So first of all, let me say I prepared a PowerPoint presentation with the 150 persons in mind. So I hope you're able to see some of the slides. If not, I will be talking you through them. Thank you so much to the hosts for having this conference. It's so important. And you know, every time I open the newspaper, I realize I have to update my talk, update what I'm thinking about. And I think what you will see, instead of a story of American exceptionalism, I will be echoing some of the sentiments that were so eloquently stated at the beginning about what's going on here in Germany and in other parts of the Western world. So let me spend my short time with you today talking about some of the research I've been doing literally almost for the past two decades. I defended my dissertation on Arab American women's labor force participation in May of 2001. The unfortunate events of September of the same year provided me opportunities to receive several of the grants she mentioned because there became an immediate interest in who are Arabs and who are Muslims. So what I want to do is first set the stage for the contemporary U.S. context in terms of how Muslims are viewed. And broadly speaking, there is hostility towards Islam. hostility towards Muslims, and widespread belief that Islam is antithetical to democratic values and to a democratic way of life. What I'm going to spend time doing is telling you what the evidence shows, the evidence to date on who U.S. Muslims are. So first, I'm going to talk about what the perceptions of Americans are towards Muslims in general and U.S. Muslims specifically. And then I'm going to give you some of the realities, who are U.S. Muslims. And I think this is an important, in a conference where we're dealing with a lot of complicated issues, that the demographic makeup of U.S. Muslims is distinct. And so I'm going to spend a few minutes on that. First, let me show you what the most recent nationwide poll of the Pew Research Center found. If you can't see this, I will briefly just sort of go over it for you. So this was the 2017 nationwide survey of U.S. adults that found, I can't see the prompter, so I hope you will bear with me, that nearly half, 41% of U.S. Muslims, or sorry, of U.S. adults, felt that Islam is more likely than other religions to encourage violence. 50%, so one out of two Americans, think that Islam is not part of mainstream U.S. society. And 25% think that most U.S. Muslims, not just most Muslims worldwide, but most U.S. Muslims are anti-American. Another way to think about this is if you're walking down the street as a Muslim in the U.S., the likelihood is one out of four people may be thinking you're anti-American. But this general picture doesn't really tell the whole story. The first slide I had of Donald Trump, President Trump, signing the executive order that in part had the travel ban on seven Muslim majority countries to the US that put a cap on refugees entering the US. So this next slide sort of shows this is the US general public. What's really driving this are individuals who affiliate with the Republican Party, which if you don't know in the US is more on the conservative, on the far right, and evangelical Christians, which by and large, there's a huge overlap. So what the slide, if you can't see it, shows is that the average, for example, of Islam not being a part of mainstream society, if that's one out of two Americans, 68% of Republicans and 67% of evangelical Christians think this is the case. So these general averages are sort of hiding a deeper hostility among some segments of U.S. society. And by the way, these are also the segments who are more likely to vote very conservatively on all issues around immigration. The next slide I really do hope you can see, because this is sort of a sad but true story. This is a picture of a truck that my husband took on his way to work in the Raleigh-Durham area just a week ago. If you can't see it, it says, "They got jihad, we got drones, works for me." And so what I put up on this slide is really the broad issues that I want to debunk. One is the conflation of Islam with Arab ethnicity. There's a widespread belief that Arabs and Muslims are the same, which isn't true, but what's more problematic is that both, or either or, are a threat to American values and they're a threat to national security. Moreover, there's a belief that the Islamic identity, the religious identity, supersedes all other identities, which is why they think they're anti-American. If you're Muslim, you can't also be an American. You can't have both identities. And because of your religious identity, that also is conflated with support of violent extremism. And then ultimately, the idea of like, why are they anti-American? There's a belief that they cannot integrate into American society. And every society has different measures of integration. But by and large in the US, like being well-educated, contributing to the economy, family values. And so across these domains, there's a belief that Muslims are less progressive, largely tied to issues around the hijab. I've done a lot of research on this. The belief that they're backwards because of the way they treat their women, that women don't have choices, and that they are uneducated and not able to integrate. So I'm going to switch gears now and talk to you about, if those are the perceptions, what are the actual realities of U.S. Muslims? So, in a nutshell. So in the US context, actually the majority of Muslims aren't Arab, and the next slide I'm going to sort of show you the sort of the overlap. The Arab population in the US is more likely to be Christian. About two-thirds of Arab Americans are Christian, they didn't convert to the US, you know, Christianity, they're Coptic, Greek Orthodox. And then the US Muslim population, the largest subset is South Asian, about one out of four are Arab American or Middle Eastern descent. And then there's a sizable African American population. The other stereotype about them not being able to integrate or be politically active, there's a million different statistics I could have shown you, but you're welcome to go to the Pew site. I'm lifting from it, it's publicly available, is the idea that Islam is in natural conflict with democracy. So, you know, the idea that they can't be politically active. Well, in fact, 82% of Muslims in the US are US citizens. 42% were born in the US, and another 40% naturalized. So only 18% of the Muslim population in the US is not a citizen. They're mainly affluent. I'm going to show you a slide in a minute, because again, this idea that they can't contribute, they're more well-educated than the US population. They're more likely to live in households with $100,000 or more income. These are sort of markers of affluence. And they're quite active politically. And then this point number four, this religiously similar to Christians. So this is echoing, Nasir, you were talking about the anti-Semitic versus an anti-Islam, like a natural like affiliation. Quite frankly, evangelical Christians and Muslims vote very, very similarly, especially on hot button issues like abortion rights, gay marriage, homosexual marriage. And so I'll show you that in a few minutes as well. But the belief is that if they're Muslim, then they're opposite of what the Christians believe in their values. Okay, this is, you know, basic, but I think it's worth showing, at least in the US context, for most of you who, you know, you may be aware of this, but this separating the Muslim religion from Arab ethnicity. And in the US, as I just mentioned, two-thirds of the Muslim population is of other ethnic origins. So I pulled these two pictures. I don't know if you can see in the back, but getting back to the issue of integration, the top corner picture is a picture of a family attending a Detroit Pistons basketball game. There is nothing more American than going to an athletic event with your family. Also shows she's wearing the hijab. Anyone know who the person is in the bottom right, if you can see it? So Arima Fahih, she was a 2010 Miss USA, a Lebanese second generation born to a Shi'i family. And she is currently a professional wrestler. So that's her, I'm not joking, that's her at a wrestling competition with her Miss USA crown on. So again, of course, I can cherry pick different pictures to show you extremes. But the idea is that there's a lot of evidence that shows similar things, that wearing the hijab doesn't mean anything. A lot of women in the hijab are very integrated and working in high professions in the US. Okay, I want to also show you just evidence. I mean, this is, you know, this gets back to the academic in me. If I'm going to say something, I want to prove it. The idea that U.S. Muslims are similar to Christians, so I wanted to kind of keep it simple, but the first one just shows how often they say they pray every day, because the belief is that Muslims are so much more religiously devout, and because of that, that's problematic. When in fact, the national surveys typically show that they fall lockstep with Christians, if not slightly less than. In terms of, let's see if I can see this, the two sort of big issues that helped get Donald Trump elected, in addition to his anti-immigration stance, issues surrounding heterosexual marriage and abortion rights. It's 2:30 a.m. my time in the U.S., so I'm struggling a little. Has anyone followed what's just happened in the U.S. in terms of the Supreme Court nomination with Brett Kavanaugh? Ooh, yes, well, I'm going to be going home to a whole new world. So a lot of this is about constitutional rights that can be overturned with these changes under Donald Trump. All right, two or three more slides, because I want to talk about the elephant in the room, which is the fear of violent extremism, like the fact that Muslims, it's one thing to be anti-American, but are they a threat to national security? So what do we know? Well, first of all, the realities are, being a Muslim in the US is not, they don't see that as separate from being able to be an American. So the question of, are you proud to be a Muslim? Yes. Are you proud to be American? Yes. Do you rate one over the other? There wasn't a lot of difference. Does anyone know who this picture is? This is, well, I put his name up on there because I was, see if I can catch up with my own notes here. Khizir Khan, so his son died in the Iraqi war fighting for the United States, and this was him at a Trump, responding at a Trump rally, holding up the Constitution, the U.S. Constitution. So again, there is a lot of angst towards, are Muslims a threat? But there's also a lot of proof that Muslims are already integrated, but we tend not to see that in the news or read about it or know. Even here we are, you know, nearly two decades after 9/11. Okay. I want to talk about this for a few minutes. It's important to me. I've got two daughters. I have one who's a sophomore in high school, 15 years old, who helped lead her school to a march against gun violence, and they got a busload and left at 4 a.m., drove to Washington, D.C. to march in the Capitol. And the reason I say this is because since 9/11, the number of deaths in the U.S. that have been linked to Islamic violence, I don't like to put the Islamic extremism and violence all together, but the number of deaths since 9/11 in the US, 140. The total, and I put homicides here because it's not just death, but total deaths in the United States, murders, in the same time period, not linked to anything to do with Islam, 260,000. If you have a calculator, you can look it up, but I did it and it's 0.05%. Let me say that again, 0.05% is of the total deaths. That's not to say, and I'm not here to say that there aren't risks. We have gotten very good, the Department of Homeland Security has gotten very good at surveillance and tracking people. And so, but the reality is the number of actual deaths and plots in the US that have been carried out have been quite small. And again, I'll provide the sources for all of this. These are all reports that are coming out of different, the CIA, Department of Homeland Security, and then actually in the Triangle area, they've got a center on terrorism. And so the latest data is that in 2017, 33 US Muslims were identified with attempting plots of violence. Half of those plots were intended to be carried out abroad. That was a decline of 25% from 2016. So again, a lot of evidence to suggest that there is a lot of fear, but we're, you know, this, if you were to ask the average American these statistics, I could promise you they would get nowhere close to this in terms of what their perceptions are. So I'm going to end with this because I definitely want to open it up. I know you've been very patient and sitting through a very strong, bright sun to open it up to the panel for your questions. But just in sum, you know, if the perceptions or stereotypes, if you will, at least in the U.S. context of Muslims as being majority Arab, majority non-citizen, less educated, not integrated, all the evidence is to the contrary of those popular perceptions. And I'll leave it on sort of a more open-ended note that, you know, in terms of American integration, there's a lot of evidence to suggest that U.S. Muslims are integrated on numerous measures, but yet they face, and I didn't discuss this in the talk, but we can, severe challenges in terms of discrimination, racism, that are serving as obstacles, particularly to the second generation, more so even than the immigrants, the children who've been born there as U.S. citizens and who feel like they cannot achieve the American dream because of their identity as Muslim. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Professor Reed, for this excellent lecture and for revealing some structural backgrounds of Islamophobia in the U.S., from which we can learn a lot for the German context, I guess. After these deep and enlightening lectures, I would like to pose a question to each of our speakers, and after that we will open up the panel for you, of course. Professor Rana, I will start with you. You have shown that within the phenomenon of Islamophobia, Islam is not thought of as a race per se, but you have shown that the concepts of race, culture, and ethnicity are mixed into a block that allows to stigmatize this group under the label of Islam. So we in Germany can observe that in anti-Muslim statements, it is always insisted that it is legitimate to criticize this religion or religions in general. So it has to be allowed. Do you also know this argument from the US, and how would you deal with it? Next question is for you, Professor Meijer. Professor Meijer quoted the scholar Bonilla Sevilla, I hope I spelled it right, who stated that racialization should be explained by those who experience it. And considering your path of comparing anti-Semitism and Islamophobia, what will you say do we need from inside, like from those people who experience it, so from Muslim and Jewish communities, to foster an explanation from inside? And last but not least, Professor Reed, in your study, you uncovered the consequences that arise from the labeling of Muslims as unable to integrate. By marking them as a potential threat, the Islamophobic attacks they experience are not taken serious, which means their civil rights, actually, especially as a minority, are not fully granted. So the question is, are there alliances to combat the situation within the context of the POC movement, for example, or the Black Lives Matter movement? Or do American Muslims understand themselves as a single group apart from other minorities in America? So, who wants to start? Floor is yours, Professor Anna.
Okay, I guess we'll go in order.
Yeah.
I think that's a great question, and I think certainly religion is something that there's nothing wrong at all with critiquing or criticizing religion, but the problem arises in the explanations that come from criticisms of religion, particularly the logics and rationales that would explain, right, the problem with religion as not only being cultural, but being in, and this is where this transition from culture, I would argue, becomes racism, right? That there are these essences that can't possibly be changed because that's the way they are, right? That move is the dangerous one. And that's precisely where, you know, again, it's no longer theological when there's theological critiques or theological debates. That's perfectly fine and great. It's precisely when those arguments become fixed that you began to see this kind of emergent thinking or a kind of thinking that explains, well, that's their problem. That's the problem of a group that we can assign as a threat or as an enemy to the a particular way of life, which is, you know, to say that, excuse me, that with the, and you know, excuse me for jargon, but I can explain this more. But the idea of liberal modernity, the kinds of things that are the inheritance of Europe, or even the kind of practices that happen in democracies, that the idea of rights and the kind of, whether they be individual rights or collective rights, that those things are one way of life and that there's another way of life that's against that. So there's this kind of emergent way that those who are not part of modernity or outside of modernity. Now, even this idea that there are some people who inherit modernity, right, I would argue, and again, this is the kind of work that I just slightly talked about. I mean, it's fuller in the paper. Thinking about capitalism as racial capitalism, the argument that Cedric Robinson makes and that a number of scholars have been thinking about, to address thinking of the way that there are those who are seen as fulfilling the logic of modernity and those who are anti-modern, right? So this isn't just about the nation state per se, it's about how we think about the world itself, right? And I think that in the keynote last night, the phrase that really caught my attention was sort of the idea of the post-colonial immigrant into Europe, the post-colonial immigrant around the world, and how that disrupts so many of these logics around modernity itself. So I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So on your questions, I'd kind of take a step back from the way in which you framed it to say that one of the observations I would make is that Muslim communities are struggling to have the right to be heard as subjects of racialization or as people who experience Islamophobia. Because when they raise it, they're characterized as often complaining or as making unreasonable demands in a way in which I think is different to anti-Semitism. I think certainly in my country, very few people who want to be taken seriously, would say that Jewish minorities are complaining about anti-Semitism, because my society, as much as yours and others, has, I suppose, had been through an educative process to understand that these things are legitimate things for minorities to raise and expect societies to take seriously. So part of the challenge is, I think, for Muslims to be heard when they raise Islamophobia as something which is a serious issue for society at large and not just something for Muslims, I would say.
Thank you very much.
So to answer your question, just in case someone came in late and didn't hear it at the beginning about in the U.S. are Muslim Americans trying to fight for their civil rights and the civil rights violations in coalition with other minority groups who are also experiencing discrimination and racism, or do they see themselves on their own and fighting it for it on their own? And I think that's evolved over time. So right after 9/11, Muslim Americans weren't super politically active or mobilized. So they were coalition building and largely with the black Muslim community, because African Americans in the US have more legitimacy in terms of fighting civil rights violations, thanks to our legacy of slavery and all of the things that have happened in the ensuing years. But since then, I feel like that they have had to sort of mobilize on their own, because the academic term's identity politics, but if you're fighting for your rights as a black person versus fighting for your rights as a woman versus fighting for your rights based on age discrimination. So over time, the Muslim American community has become much more mobilized in and of itself and in its own right, and has its own groups who sort of fight for changes and lobbyists. But that's not always been the case.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And although the questions of Hafsa were, of course, brilliant, I would like to open the floor to you and questions that you have or issues you want to ask our three panelists. And we have this wonderful colleague with the microphone, precisely.
Thank you. I have a question, comment.
Maybe not everybody maybe knows who you are. Okay. That we address with the name, and then, because not everybody was there yesterday.
All right. I am Meijer-van Enoğlu. I have a question / comment to Nasser. You mentioned Theo Goldberg and Agamben. So my comments are related to their arguments. I wasn't quite able to catch your point on their two points. One is Theo Goldberg, which I also use in my own work, makes this brilliant argument when he's examining the different formations of racialization and racism. Like in Africa, the format of racism in South Africa is radically different than the one in US and Europe. When he's talking about the European racism, the specificity of it is this. I think this is very, very crucial. This is a contentious point, I realize, but I agree with it. He says, by privileging Holocaust as the only form of racism that Europe has ever committed, right? It enables Europe to deny racism in colonialism. It's like the format, he uses this word. Oh my God, how did we do it to people who are like us, legitimizes racism in the colony? Oh, we can be racist towards the others, people who are different from us. So I'm curious about your take on that, which I find very brilliant. The other point is on Agamben. I'll try to keep it short. I'm sure there are other questions. Agamben, the Muslim in the camp, yeah. Again, I use this a lot. This is Agamben's explanation for the reasons for the people who are on the verge of death, who haven't died yet, yeah, but who lost their humanity, to be called Musliman. Oh, it must be because Islam, as a faith, is a submissive one. It submits itself to God. So probably those people who are on the verge of dying had this submissive condition, and that's why. I think this is extremely, extremely problematical. There are lots of different takes on this. And one of the key arguments is that, I'm also making that, is that it is speaking by calling these people who are on the verge of death, Musliman, is the symptom of the European unconscious in a way, that which is also uttered among the Jews in the camp. So I'm just, yeah. So this is not quite a question, but I wasn't able to catch your point on those two.
Sorry, I don't want to be impolite, and it's very interesting what you're unfolding here at the moment. And I can imagine that you directly want to respond, but I do want to give the floor to two other questions, and then, because maybe they're entangled, because it's all about entangled perspectives today, and then you can answer, and then we have, then we move on. Yes. Who are you?
I'm Zakaria Keskin-Kalic from Alice Salomon University. My question goes to Professor Reed. Thank you very much for your presentation. I was very much interested in how you try to compare certain stereotypes with the evidence, and I was thinking about the introduction of Orientalism in Said's critique of Orientalism, when he says that the critique of Orientalism is actually not interested in how far Orientalism fits to the real image of the real Orient, because there is no Orient anyway. So when you say, when you look at images of Muslims and you say that most people think that Muslims are Arabs, and you say, no, but 25% of them are Arabs, so my question is, what is an Arab? Why and for how long? Because I'm afraid that even in the term of Arab, there is a certain biological component. So my question is it a self-identification of Arab? Is it speaking Arabic? Even that is not the case, because many people who identify as Arab do not necessarily speak Arabic. And then how do we identify as Arabs? To which generation? When does it stop actually to be Arab? So in how far does Arabness carry on the idea of like Muslimness, because these things can be used synonymously, so it's actually not even important if the Muslim is an Arab or not an Arab. So this leads to my general question, is it even necessary to compare prejudices to the evidence if I believe there is no reality of the Muslim anyway?
Whoa. My dear, please think about an answer. Gertrude Stein, an Arab is not an Arab is not an Arab. A third question, and then I'll give the floor to you.
Right.
When there is a... I have to make a decision. Oh, you already have the mic. Yeah, well, that's...
I'll keep it short. I'm Shireen.
That's a power relation here. Yeah. Who has the
I'm
mic?
I'm from Long Island University in New York, and I'm following up with the gentleman in front of me. And my question is to Professor Rui. Also, I think it was interesting that missing from the power the slide was the death of the three Muslims people in North Carolina, where you actually teach. And also, I think, sort of following that, we need to be very careful when we try to sell our level of integration as Muslims into the Americanness, because that sort of perpetuates a certain narrative that the onus is on us to fit in, and who is this us, who is this American, and what does that even mean? Picking up on when you spoke about how integrated Muslims are, and the fact that it almost sounded, you actually did say that even though the women wear hijab, they're very integrated. So those kind of comments, we need to be very, very careful when we put that out. And most Muslims are not in the poverty range, and this is how much, I mean, that is very relevant when you were talking about issues of Muslim racism, and to me that sort of perpetuates a certain narrative that, to take on what the gentleman said, really is something that Edward Said criticizes. That's where I'll stop. Thank you.
Thank you. So no, I appreciate the comments. I'll answer them in the reverse order. What I should have said is, when I was talking about integration, I was really using the broader framework in the U.S. that has nothing to do with Muslims, the long history of immigrant integration, drawing on the immigration literature. So absolutely not speaking about, like, Muslims should integrate into a certain fold of Americanness, but rather the history of, I'm thinking about Alba and Nee and Portes and Rumbaugh's work on immigration, the history of immigration, Nancy Foner's work as well, into the U.S. And related to this, your question about, are they Arab, are they Muslim, are they not, absolutely doesn't matter, other than it's a phenotypical, like the stereotype. And so whether or not someone self-identifies as Arab or South Asian, the idea is that they're just, I'm saying whitewashed, but it's actually kind of the opposite. It's about a phenotypical image. And, you know, right after 9/11, Sikhs were being discriminated against and vandalized. And, you know, to the other question about why I didn't speak about the three murders in North Carolina, in the 15 or 20 minutes, I was trying to figure out the best sort of, like, what's the information that I could put out there. That's why I did show the picture of the truck, driving down the I-40. That's very sort of anti-Islamic sentiment. Thank you.
Shall I? Okay, well, thank you very much, Maida. You achieved the remarkable feat of asking two great questions and answering them with two great responses in the same moment. So I very much share with you your observation about Goldberg's analysis of colonialization, imperialism, and genocide outside of Europe. And in fact, you know, there's a couple of books, Dominic Scheller and Moses Dirk, who say that actually it's impossible to understand the Holocaust unless you understand the treatment of the Harara people in Namibia and Germany's historic role in that. So I am totally persuaded about the importance of understanding racialization in both a global and historical context, and I'm grateful for the point that you make. So too on the second point, and I'm glad you raised the controversial issue from the floor rather than I from the podium. There's just one other point I was going to make in relation to Agamben. I share with you your analysis of his limitations, which is why I said that he recoils from relating the story of the Muslimana to a wider racialization story. And in fact, he invokes certain racialized characteristic stereotypes to make his point. I mean, the Muslim for him is not a figure with agency. It's a caricature that he uses to narrate a story, which is why I turned to Goldberg. I mean, there was something I was going to say on your second point about how the Holocaust being a defining characteristic of European racism comes with an ability to therefore narrow the story of European racialization as well. And it's the statement that Esther Romayan makes, and I've made this with her in the room, and she said, feel free to make it, but emphasize the if. So this is a statement that I didn't read out, and she says, if the Holocaust provides a moral compass for a new Europe. Its lessons need to be universalized and extended beyond the uniqueness of the Holocaust and the specificity of antisemitism and Jewish suffering to include all forms of racialization, historically and culturally, which I think in it contains a requirement for Europeans to look seriously and deeply about their role in the world, which I think she's arguing, and you are too, that an emphasis on one episode of historical racialization and genocide perhaps prevents people from looking at others. But you made the controversial point, not me. I'm just saying that for the record.
Okay. we have time for another two questions. There was one here in the front. Please, Mike. Yeah. Because I was sort of shortcutting you out before, so you are the first in the second round.
Yeah. Okay, just very quickly.
Who are you?
That's a very big question. existential, we don't have time to worry about that. I'm Salman Sayed, I'm at the University of Leeds.
Okay.
Nasser, just a quick clarification, and I maybe just misheard you. You mentioned in the Pew survey that there was a relationship between those who were anti-Semitic and those who had anti-Muslim sentiments, I think something like that. And then later on you talked about people like Geert Wilders and Le Pen who were making these kind of, what was, you know, so this Europe is being a haven for European Jewry, etc., and they're still Islamophobic. So I was just wondering how you tie those two things together. Because one argument would be, and I think Andres Breivik illustrates that very clearly, that one of the things we've seen is a transformation among the right in Europe, which historically was completely obsessed with anti-Semitism, and how it has become translated into Islamophobia and, on occasions, pro-Zionism. That doesn't mean they're not anti-Semitic. But we can't, if you saw the pictures of Breivik, and again, he's an emblematic symbol. He dresses up as a crusader. Yeah. He defends Israel as the bastion of white civilization. And he talks about Islamophobia. So it seems to be a very kind of complex move which is happening, which underlies our common sense understanding of the right. So I just wanted to know how you fit that into this survey about the relationship between the two.
We're still gathering. I will not ask who you are, because that's indeed a very complex question, but the name is... there was one, the lady in the back, yes, and then you can answer. Yeah.
Ah, oh, sorry. Yeah. Thank you very much. My name is Kauthar Qasim, and I want also to come back to the question of anti-Zionism and the attempt to make anti-Zionism being defined as anti-Zionism, which is as anti-Semitism, sorry. So the idea of Islamophobia or anti-Muslim racism is denying also the Muslim identity to certain parts of European citizens, and part of it is also ignoring their narratives and not being willing to integrate their narratives into a European narrative. So if making anti-Zionism
let us not talk about
making anti-Zionism understood anti-Semitism. As anti-Semitism, is also denying and not recognizing the experiences of people who were impacted also by political Zionism in their countries of origin, with their families and so on. And this has something to do also with anti-Muslim racism, in my opinion. So maybe you can comment on this.
What your question is, and to specify it, and that we... It's pretty clear, okay. But to whom? To whom? Okay. Do you want to answer? Who wants to answer?
Okay, well, I'll have a go at Professor Salman slash Bobby Said from Leeds University. So I think I think you've put your finger on the prevailing tension in all of this, which has to do with the difference between mass attitudes and political actors, but also I think the difference between anti-Semitism and Judaophilia, and to say that people are adopting the anti... We are opposed to anti-Semitism as a political discourse, but actually are deeply anti-Semitic in terms of their social and cultural attitudes. And that would be very true of Breivik, and it's also true of organizations like the EDL, who see as a political modality the kind of reinscription of whiteness in these kind of in these moves. So you've picked up on that example. And I think the two can run parallel to each other. I mean, the attitudes of mass publics don't necessarily have to correspond to the attitudes of the far right, who adopts a particular position with respect to, you know, anti-Semitism or something else. I think it's a strategic political maneuver in terms of adopting an anti. I mean, this would be also be true of people like Viktor Orban, you know, somebody who has a long-standing track record of deeply anti-Semitic politics is now characterizing himself as a defender of Jewry in Europe. You know, I mean, it's the adoption and the political adoption of a position rather than a reflection of a you know, of something sincere or progressive, or, you know, as kind of anti-racists would hold it. I mean, you're kind of you're not persuaded by that.
Wait on for the mic. The acoustics is very bad in this room. I know, so.
I think a lot of what you're saying depends on reading intentionality, deep intentionality of why people are doing these things. And the point that I wasn't making wasn't this is just this a tip of these kind of elite political operators, but a transformation in the culture. And I think that's something that has to be put together, that in a way that the exclusion of different kinds of groups. So for example, the invention of the Judeo-Christian.
Yeah.
When does that occur?
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
not something that you'd find all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
It occurs at a certain moment in time.
True.
It becomes hegemonic at a certain moment of time.
Yeah.
And it retranslates
yeah.
that relationship between the Judaic presence and the construction of Europe.
Sure.
So it seems to me that if what we're seeing is a much bigger transformation rather than simply a matter of political calculus, because even the matter of political calculus only makes sense in relation to the fact that there is a kind of a cultural terrain which is being transformed.
Yeah, but I already made your point in my presentation where I told you that there's something going on in terms of Matty Bunzel's argument, which is to say that the nature of anti-Semitism in Europe has changed. It's no longer about the nation state. Actually, there's something going on at a civilizational level which is used to flip and to say actually the challenge which is greatest to us is those Muslims, you know, who don't share our long-standing historical inheritance of culture and value and tradition and so on. So the quote that I gave you by Geert Wilders summed that up. You know, he brought together Athens, Rome, and Jerusalem. So you're restating my point, and
yeah,
it's a welcome point.
Sorry, just very, very
gentlemen.
Just one last point. I don't think Geert Wilders, you can't simply read him as doing this opportunistically. I don't think there's any reason for that. That's the only point.
No,
That's why the point of clarification.
That's the thing with academics, you know. I think we run out of time.
Well, I've already had a go at one. So, does somebody want to take that up? Go on, Junaid.
Well, if there are so many
question marks in related to this question, maybe we should not answer it.
Actually, we have an offering for all of you, because yesterday we had a great keynote by Professor Meijer-van, but we didn't have the chance to pose some questions to her. So today we had the idea that we now close this great panel, but we go on with Professor Meijer-van, and you, all of you, have the chance to pose some questions. So I think you certainly have the possibility to address our speakers that will be here and available for you, so you can pose your questions. And we will have now Professor Meijer-van on our panel, and we finally would like to express our sincere thanks to all of our speakers and wish you a great conference.
Woo!